Our next speaker is Jeanette Kotaleski. She's from the Royal Institute of Technology, Stockholm, and she will talk about multi-scale modeling exemplified in the basal ganglia. And she also plans on giving a brief update on the Swedish INCF nodal activities.
Okay. So first of all, I would like to thank the organizers for inviting me. It's particularly nice to leave Sweden this time of the year and go to a warm place like this. So I will discuss some modeling we have done in the basal ganglia on several scales. And when I sort of read the program for the workshop, it was supposed to be like integration or sensory motor integration. So I will sort of pick examples that relate to synaptic integration. I sort of realize that it's not so strict, but I will not discuss like more general things. I will highlight work we have done which sort of relates to synaptic integration. So on the we have been doing work on maybe like this. So we have been doing work on different levels, sort of with the general goal of understanding how cortical or thalamic input can be processed through the basal ganglia and reach the output stages, which in turn control these motor centers in the brainstem and thalamus. And of course, on the systems level, one can ask a lot of interesting questions, but here I will just discuss an example where we have started to look at the role of short-term plasticity in the system. If we want to understand the basal ganglia on the systems level and how it gates and process information from the cortex and so on, then of course it's necessary to also go into in detail and look at the different stages and how is the neural network looking and what are the membrane properties and so on. So on the sort of neural network level, I will discuss some work related to synaptic integration in two different kinds of neurons in the input stage of the basal ganglia. And when you start to discuss the neural network level, then you quite soon start to ask questions that really relates to learning and how the connectivity is affected by activity and so on. And then you are already on the subcellular level. And on the subcellular level, we can identify and investigate rules for learning, for synaptic plasticity, and so on. And if we can discover those rules and understand some of the prerequisites on this level, then of course we can make some much more educated guesses how the input is working on this level and probably also on this level. So I will start with the microcircuitry level or the neural network level because that is sort of in between. So in the input stage of the basal ganglia, most of the cells are medium spiny neurons, and those are the only cells that actually project to the next step stage of the basal ganglia. It's like 90% or so of all the cells that are medium spiny neurons. And since those are the only cells that project to the next stage, it's really important to understand how they process cortical and thalamic input and convey it to the next stage. And several factors are in play here, of course. We have the connectivity in the synapses, of course, the connectivity strength from cortex. Another factor could be like modulatory substances such as dopamine or acetylcholine or serotonin and so on. And a third factor is inhibition from neighboring neurons, and particularly fast spiking interneurons, feed forward inhibition from fast spiking interneurons. So I will start by discussing some modeling work we did on fast spiking interneurons a couple of years ago. So the fast spike interneurons, they provide powerful feed-forward inhibition to these medium spiny neurons. And these neurons are also coupled with gap junctions, electrical synapses. So if we have several of those presynaptic to medium spiny neurons and they are coupled by gap junctions, then the question was whether these gap junctions make them spike synchronized, because if they synchronize, then of course they could control spike timing in medium spiny neurons quite extensively. So the starting point was a quite detailed fast spike interneuron model we had built earlier. It is compartmentalized and with Hodgkin-Huxley currents, and we made particular effort into placing out synaptic AMPA and GABA synaptic synapses over the cell surface to be able to reproduce postsynaptic current amplitude relationships and postsynaptic current inter-event interval distributions, and during like ongoing activity in vivo. But unfortunately, there exists no data from in vivo studies. So the best thing that one can do is to take data from, for instance, Cook cultures. That is at least much better than guessing. So this is sort of a starting point, and it means also that when we simulate this cell, we can also pretend that it is sitting in a network. So then the question is, if we want to understand how a network of gap junction-coupled fast spike interneurons can affect a postsynaptic medium spiny neuron, then we also have to see what kind of network that a postsynaptic medium spiny neuron might be affected through. And this is a reasonable network, like 10 neurons, 5, 10 neurons. It has been estimated that it should be 4 or 2, maybe up to 27 fast spike interneurons that could project to one medium spiny neuron. So this is a reasonable network that one can play around with. And then it's also known that gap junctions occur between these neurons to some extent. So we simulate these neurons when they are driven, activated by synaptic input, and also these neurons, they are not identical. They have variable cell properties, as you have heard earlier today, could be very important. Otherwise, you for sure run into a lot of artifacts because the cells are identical. And also one can tune the gap junction strength to try to reproduce what has been measured. And then this is an example of when you activate this network with simulated synaptic input, then the cell spikes, different cells with different colors, of course. And then the question is whether it is so that these spikes are synchronized because of the gap junctions or not, or to what extent they are synchronized. And then one way to illustrate that, so that you see it with the eye, is to make a histogram of all the different interspike intervals that you see among these spikes. And if you simulate this network over a certain time period and do that, then it could look like this if you have no gap junctions in this tensile network. So there are no really preferred interspike intervals, of course. But if you reproduce the same simulation, the identical simulation for the same amount of time, but you introduce gap junctions, then it looks like that. So first of all, you see that there are fewer interspike intervals compared to this one, and that means it's fewer spikes, right? And there is a peak in the middle, close to zero, which means that there is a tendency that we have some spikes occurring quite close in time. But the dominating effect is this reduction in spikes. So this is spike pair occurrences in such a network if you increase gap junctions conductance. And if you just look at cells that are coupled with the gap junctions, it doesn't change much. But the total effect in the network is a reduction in spikes. And of course, the role of gap junctions is probably not just to reduce the number of spikes. That seems to be an inefficient way. So a situation where this could actually make a difference is the following one. So if we have this network of FS neurons, but they are not coupled by gap junctions, and then you just bombard them with synaptic input, and then during a brief period in time, you sort of transient increase in the synchronicity of the inputs to the different cells, so that these cells sense the same temporal pattern of synaptic input, but you don't change the intensity. So if the cells are not coupled, there is no change really. You won't notice anything. But if such a network is coupled with gap junctions, then you see a bump. So a gap junction coupled network is very good at picking up short periods of synchronous inputs. And that is because what is actually reducing the spike numbers here is that you shunt current through the gap junctions. And if the cells have sort of a similar temporal profile, this is not occurring to the same extent. So if you put this network as a presynaptic network to a medium spiny neuron, and this peak is sort of timed to spiking in the medium spiny neuron, it actually appears that you can delay or even kill 60% more of the spikes with just this presynaptic network. And also I should say that this is, of course, not exactly how it is in reality. This is more like how it is in reality, that this network is, of course, embedded in a much larger network of FS neurons, but it still works. So this is So first of all, it was a bit unexpected for us that the main effect of gap junctions was actually to shunt away spikes, because experimentalists had already shown that they are very good at synchronizing spikes. So to convince ourselves that we didn't do really a mistake, we had to sort of simulate the exact experimental setup. And then it is the following one, that you can inject current into cells and they start to spike. This is the same network that we have here. And first we have no gap junctions, so they spike a bit asynchronous. And then we introduce gap junctions in the simulation and then they line up perfectly. And then when the gap junctions are removed, then they start to desynchronize again. And so this is quite different. If you have current injection, you get a perfect spike synchronization, but if you drive them with synaptic input, that is not the case. And moreover, in this setting, when you increase gap junctions conductance, you decrease spiking. But in this setting, if you increase gap junctions conductance, you can increase spiking. And in this particular case, it's because of a recruitment effect, that if all of these cells line up, then they can recruit more cells. So that is, I think, a quite good example that I think that a role for quite biophysically detailed models is really to extrapolate from experiments to a more physiological setting. I guess that sometimes you would think that experiments are closer to reality, but I think that doesn't have to be the case, that sometimes you actually have to maybe reproduce some experimental data, but then take it to a more physiologically realistic setting. So that was sort of some work that exemplify the role of gap junctions for detecting synchronous inputs to a gap junction coupled network. And the feedforward inhibition from such FS networks are, of course, important for controlling spiking in medium spiny neurons. And another important factor is, of course, to control the synaptic strength from cortex to medium spiny neurons. And here, plasticity comes in. And as in many other systems, there exist various experimental paradigms for LTP and LTD, high-frequency stimulation trains or low-frequency or theta bursts and so on. And over the last 5 years or so also, STDP experiments have become popular. STDP, spike timing dependent plasticity. So here there is a difference in the resulting plasticity, LTP or LTD, depending on the timing between the presynaptic activation of the neuron and the postsynaptic spike. And for instance, if you have a very sort of uncomplicated situation where only NMDA properties are important and NMDA calcium trigger the plasticity and so on, then what you typically get is that if you start with a presynaptic input followed by a postsynaptic spike, then you get a higher calcium influx because you remove the magnesium block of NMDA. But if you do the opposite, post followed by pre, you get a lower calcium influx. It's not this simple in the medium spiny neurons. So the question that we're asking is how the MSN behavior, the medium spiny neuron behavior and learning can be controlled by both excitatory input, glutamatergic input, but also the presence of GABAergic inputs, and particularly when it comes to plasticity. So we collaborate with an experimental group in France that are doing these STDP experiments, and they have corticostriatal slices. And then they see the following, that if they, in the control situation, then they actually see that post followed by pre gives LTP, the black dots, and pre followed by post gives LTD. But their results has not been really in accordance with what other labs has got. And then they try to nail it down, what is the difference, and then they notice that if you block GABA in the slice, which has been a typical, this is what typical people do, then you reverse plasticity. So then post-pre gives LTD and pre-post gives LTP. And this is a quite robust situation. It has been tested in mice and in rodents and in direct pathway neurons and in indirect pathway neurons and so on. And in all cases, if you have LTP in this case or LTP in this case, it's always dependent on NMDA calcium, because if you block NMDA properties, then you remove LTP. And this LTD situation is dependent on endocannabinoid production and L-type calcium that is necessary for that. And if you block GABA, a lot of things can, of course, happen. You have the whole a lot of networks effect that can happen. So to see whether this switching of the LTP and LTD in the presence of GABA could be explained on the single cell level, sort of, they did the following experiments, that they recorded from two neighboring medium spiny neurons, and then they had picrotoxin in the electrode in one of these cells. And then when they gave, like, post followed by a pre-input, these cells behave different. So the control condition, there you have LTP and the other one LTD. And the opposite is true if the protocol is pre followed by post. So it seems that the presence of GABA can make a difference for spike time independent plasticity in this system and during these experimental conditions. And it seems that LTP requires NMDA calcium, while LTD does not require NMDA calcium and instead rather L-type calcium and endocannabinoid production. So what can happen here? And to try to get some idea on that, we have a detailed medium spiny neuron model where we try to get the right behavior on the back propagating action potentials that goes out in the dendrite. It's TTX dependent, and we also try to get a reasonable calcium dynamics. And then this cell is stimulated with the same kind of STDP protocol that the experimentalists use. And then we plotted NMDA calcium versus L-type calcium. This is L-type calcium, this is NMDA calcium. And the black curve is the control situation, and the red curve is when GABA is not around. So both of these types of calcium are elevated because of GABA. And that is not so strange in this system because the GABA reversal potential is above the resting membrane potential in the slice preparation, at least. So then, and this is of course interesting in itself, but then how can this explain the switch between LTP and LTD? And of course we don't know the answer, but it's quite interesting that if one plots the ratio between the NMDA calcium and the L-type calcium, it really changes when you go from a GABA-free situation to a control situation where GABA is around. And for the pre followed by post, it is sort of in line with the observation that this produces LTP, it has a lot of NMDA, and this produces LTD. The ratio switches, and actually it's the opposite thing with the opposite stimulation, but it's not so big. So this is like a starting point for trying to generate some hypothesis what is really going on. And then we are already down at the subcellular level when we start to discuss calcium, right? So some background to the subcellular level and synaptic plasticity in these medium spiny neurons. So for now we are most interested in LTP actually. And for LTP it has been, so it's sort of known that it requires some protein kinase A activation, maybe some CAM kinase 2 activation. It's not really known in the stratum, but in many other places it's like that. And also you cannot have too much activity of some of the phosphatases that are around. So therefore, some years ago we built a model of glutamate and dopamine-induced receptor-induced cascades, the very initial parts of those, and try to ask what are the prerequisites in such networks for activating, for instance, PKA, or make sure that we don't activate too much of these phosphatases and so on. And how are these kind of, how are the interactions between these pathways affecting this and so on? And also, several other groups have addressed sort of similar questions in this kind of network, sort of. And lately, most lately, our collaborators in US, Rama Blackwell and her postdoc, Oliveira, they re-implemented this network, but in a stochastic reaction diffusion model, and I will come back to that. So when we have such network, then what are interesting sort of questions to ask? So I will comment briefly upon reliability of such deterministic models and also specificity, that a lot of things remains here. And then I will discuss some ongoing work. And finally, say some words about what is necessary to test whether these learning rules works in vivo. So when it comes to specificity and reliability, if we start with the reliability question, if we just re-implement this network, the previous network, and look at the steps between cyclic AMP and PKA in the deterministic model when we give some pulses of dopamine, it could look like this. This is cyclic AMP, and then eventually you activate some PKA in this particular model. But if you redo that with the same parameters in the stochastic model, taking into account that if this network is in a small part of the cell, such as the spine. It's not so many molecules around for some of these molecules. So then it looks like that. And in this particular case, it's really difficult to see if there is any production of pKa, right? So this cannot be the case in reality. And in this context, it's interesting that this model has been re-implemented in a stochastic reaction diffusion study, where they also, in addition, played around with trying to hypothesize that, for instance, pKa and adenidate cyclase 5, the enzyme producing cyclic AMP, are co-localized. And then you can actually solve this problem, at least to some extent. And also, Uppi Bala has shown this in other contexts several years ago, that if you have like a deterministic model that shows some nice switching behavior, then it can be messed up if you have it in a stochastic model, taking into account the more realistic situation. So that is one thing. Another thing is to come back to this this observation that it seems that in the medium spiny neurons, LTP and LTD depends on different cascades, not only like the calcium level, but also different cascades. So LTP is NMDA dependent, and ERK is activated, dopamine receptor-induced cascades produce pKa and so on. And maybe there is also some PKC required for LTP. And for LTD, it's different cascades that are important. L-type calcium, endocannabinoids, and also some nitric oxide seems to be important. So then one can ask, if you just have a LTP or an LTD stimulation protocol, then why does it end up in LTP or in LTD? Because if you have a high frequency or low frequency stimulation protocol or an STT protocol, then in all of these cases, of course, some glutamate is there and some dopamine is released and some, you open up some L-type calcium channels and you activate metabotropic glutamate receptors for sure. And there is also NO around. So you have all of these things all the time, but maybe in different levels. And then what can decide whether LTP or LTD results? One possibility is of course that there is crosstalk between these cascades, so maybe one of the cascades becomes a little bit more activated and then it inhibits the other one, right? There are such indications. But also there might be dependent on the temporal activation pattern of the different inputs. It's cut here, but temporal activation patterns. And we are sort of working along those lines to extend the previous model with ERK. Because ERK has been suggested to act as a coincidence detector between dopamine and glutamate, and also it's known to be important in plasticity in LTP in this system. And ERK also actually is one of these necessary molecules to activate PKM probably in this system, PKM zeta. So, with such a sort of skeleton, and especially if you add on some extra input to this cyclic AMP part of the network, then you can also address questions related to transient increases or decreases in these modulatory systems, like dopamine or acetylcholine and so on. I just should mention that when it comes to ERK and the medium spiny neurons, it's quite complex, the situation. ERK has been studied a lot, not necessarily with a question to understand plasticity, but with a question to understand like drug addiction or side effects when you have Parkinson's and L-DOPA treatments and so on. So there are a lot of animal knockout models for ERK. And What is particularly challenging here, what we had a lot of problems with, is that if you knock out one of the genes for dopamine type 1 receptor or for the G protein in this system, then you can have effects in one pathway but not in the other. Like if you knock out the D1 receptor to a little bit more than 50%, then this pathway is affected but not this pathway. And with GOLF it's actually the opposite. So that's a bit tricky. To be able to mimic also these kind of experimental data, we are now working with a more complex dopamine model where we assume that the dopamine receptor and also the GOLF protein can be in sort of in two compartments. It sort of means that it can bind to do two different sort of anchoring molecules or something like that. But I will not discuss that. I will discuss this ongoing modeling work with regard to plasticity and whether activation pattern could play a role. So when this network is activated with an LTP protocol or an LTD protocol, we get much more ERK activation if it's an LTP protocol than if it's an LTD protocol. And it's quite interesting, we use the exact same stimulation paradigm that our collaborators in US have been used when they look at a model they have now for the LTD cascade sort of. So it's quite interesting that in the LTP model that we have more activation of ERK if we give an LTP paradigm instead of an LTD paradigm, and they have the opposite. So that's quite interesting that it might be so that for the LTD and LTP receptor-induced cascades, the activation pattern might actually select one of these pathways. But for sure, there's also some crosstalk between this pathway, maybe leading to competition and so on. So eventually, of course, it's necessary to investigate receptor-induced cascades in the context of an active neural network, right? So what we would like to do is to have a detailed neural model, and that is then typically simulated in one of these simulators. And then to place some receptor-induced cascades into the spines or dendrites of such neural models, and that is typically simulated with other simulators. And then test whether you can get some consistent activation of kinases or phosphatases that are known to be important for plasticity during ongoing network activity. To see if such mechanisms are robust enough if the network is bombarded with ongoing activity, and then this surrounding network might be implemented in NEST or something. So it's really necessary to be able to make simulators talk to each other, and we have a project ongoing, actually together with Upi Bala, to try to do this using the MUSIC tool. MUSIC is an INCF product that you might know of that is supposed to let simulators talk to each other. So now we have discussed the microcircuit level and some synaptic integration scenarios that affect maybe synaptic plasticity, medium spiny neurons, and coincidence detection in fast spiking into neural networks. And also we have seen that maybe there is some competition between pathways, or maybe some temporal pattern that either preferably leads to LTP or LTD. And to look at synaptic effects on the systems level, I thought I could show just some ongoing work that relate to short-term synaptic dynamics. So It has sort of lately been shown that in many parts of the basal ganglia there is either short-term facilitation or short-term depression in the synapses. For instance, these fast-spiking neurons, inhibition of median spiny neurons, there is a powerful depression. And in the direct pathway between the stratum, median spiny neurons, onto SNR, the output nucleus of the basal ganglia, one of those, there is facilitation, and here you have depression and so on. So just to give an example, yeah, so at this level, at sort of the systems level, we sort of use quite not so detailed models, integrate and fire or Sikivich models, try to be tuned to electrophysiological data with conductance-based synapses and most importantly synapse models that can capture the short-term plasticity sodics marker models. This is just to show one example. In experiments, this shows that when you activate these synapses between direct pathway, median spiny neurons, and SNR, it facilitates. And this is in the simulations, the conductance. And then one can of course ask, so how many median spiny neurons are necessary to suppress one SNR, taking into account that they facilitate, and what is the role of this short-term synaptic plasticity on the systems level? This is just an example. So, first of all, if asking such questions like how many median spiny neurons are necessary and so on, you also have to make some educated guesses of how the network is coupled. And yeah, we assume that at most 500 median spiny neurons can project on one SNR neuron, but probably fewer. This is just a simulation where we have 100 presynaptic median spiny neurons. So this is a population of 100 medium spiny neurons that are activated with some low frequency. And this is a synaptic, the synaptic activation frequency in a postsynaptic SNR neuron. So to increase that inhibition of SNR and thus suppress the tonic inhibition of SNR, we can increase the activity in the presynaptic MSM pool in different ways. Either we can recruit some bursting medium spiny neurons, or we can increase the spiking of the whole presynaptic medium spiny network, right? Like this. And if we take this situation and compare it with that situation and look at the how the SNR cell is affected, then this is much more effective in inhibiting the SNR cell than this is, right? And this is, of course, because the synapses are facilitatory. So facilitatory synapses, of course, filter out this background low firing MSN, but they can detect bursting MSNs. And in this particular case, it makes perfect sense, and you could have sort of guessed it, but this is sort of a quantification of that effect. And one can sort of go on with adding other inputs and addressing what happens if you have an MSN burst together with a GPE burst or a GPE pause in the same postsynaptic SNR. And it's quite interesting that if you have, this is actually shows a simulation like that. This is a frequency in the SNR. When you just test the importance of the MSN burst, then it suppresses the frequency. If you have in addition a GPE burst, then it suppresses the SNR activity much earlier. So it seems to be very good to have an MSN burst together with a GPE burst if you want to suppress a postsynaptic SNR cell really quickly. And these GPE bursts or pauses, it's not so that the whole presynaptic GPE pool are bursting or pausing, it's just like 20% of those. So also in the case where the GPE, 20% of the GPE pauses during the time when an MSN is bursting. It can actually interfere, so if we define a certain threshold for when the SNR cell is sort of inhibited, then it could be so that if 20% of the presynaptic GPE pool is pausing, then the MSNs cannot really make this suppression of activity. And this is quite interesting in relation to Parkinson's and so on, when the GPE pool becomes much more bursty. So that is what we are doing. Then just a couple of words about this, the Swedish INCF node activities. So the INCF node activities are sort of organized quite much around Stockholm Brain Institute, and the Stockholm Brain Institute consists of groups at the Karolinska Institute and Stockholm University and also Royal Institute of Technology, KTH. And there the aim has been to study higher brain functions from different perspectives during a lot of approaches like imaging, computational modeling, and experiments. And also, lately there has something called the Swedish eScience Research Center has formed. And it is formed by almost the same universities, KTH, Stockholm University, Karolinska Institute, and then another university in Sweden, around high-performance computing facilities. So now we also interact or are part of this CERC. It has a disease community, and so it fits very nicely also with the collaboration with some of the companies. So current activities and plans is to increase the interactions with researchers outside the Stockholm area, sort of, and we have done that through neuroinformatics PhD courses, joint applications, and so on. We have quite interesting activities going on in another part of Sweden where they manufacture and use electrodes for in vivo recording, so it's sort of brain-machine interfacing, and that could be very, very good if we could start to collaborate between those centers. Also, we participate in some INCF task forces programs. And also the Swedish eScience Research Center, they have employed and recruited a neuroinformatics application expert that is going to help out with both modeling, especially high-performance computing issues, and also imaging. And we have participated in the preparation of this EU Human Brain Project flagship and hosted some conferences. We will also host the Neuroinformatics Congress 2000. Or next year. And also I will just mention something about a joint PhD program that we have. It's called Eurospin. It's within the Erasmus Mundus EU programs. So the objective of this doctoral training program is to provide top quality training for PhD students within neuroinformatics and especially computational neuroscience. And four partners participate. It's KTH, Edinburgh, and it's NCBS in Bangalore, and it's University of Freiburg, and some associated partners. So if any one of you, or if you know someone who is interested in applying to be a joint student between some of these universities, then you should go to this website and fill in your name and so on, and it's deadline in the end of this month. So please spread the word, and we have actually someone from India also in the program, so that goes very well. Okay, thanks.
Are you going to also put in some abstract modeling or couple it to some of the motor physical instantiation of this?
Some what?
Some motor system, like, you know, some actual...
I mean, we have this ongoing work that Sten discussed, yeah. where the basal ganglia can control motor system, and that is really nice, because then we have actually a very good quantitative knowledge of that system. So I mean, this is ongoing, yes, of course. But I didn't take that here. I just took things that had to do with synaptic integration. And also Sten already talked about it. But I mean, this is really a resource that, I mean, a good reason for modeling motor systems as such is, of course, that you can figure out what is the purpose of something that the system is doing. And now, since we know a lot of the motor output, like the brainstem and spinal cord, then we can also much better interpret like what the basal ganglia output has to cope with, right?
So just to follow that up, I mean, are you looking at a systematic approach to abstraction? That is, you know, it's a question that I get asked all the time, so I thought I'd ask you. A systematic way of saying, here's my very detailed model, and now I have a way of taking those lessons so that I can apply them to bigger systems without doing the horrible calculations.
I guess that is what we already want. Every one of us really want to understand the brain, right? So we have to do that, right? We have no choice. But I guess we have to go into these details to figure out. And I think that these receptor-induced cascades can actually, it seems to be very detailed, but actually if you can understand like timing requirements in those, you actually already know a lot on the systems level, like you have some constraints. So I think it's, it really fits together, but it's a lot of things that remains.
Maybe I can add one more to the to-do list. But I think for first time, I think I understand the need for very, very detailed models. So could we think of extending these models to ask for the role of dopamine on plasticity? Because in striatum, dopamine also modulates even the sign of the plasticity, not just...
Yes, absolutely, absolutely. I mean, that is...
So how far these models are, like, are they in some stage where you can add one or two extra cascade and ask this question, or is it some other work?
Yeah, you can you can actually do it on different levels. So if you have a really detailed compartmentalized models with Hosking-Huxley current, then you can already, you can sort of up or down regulate some of the currents that are known to be modulated by, for instance, dopamine. And this has partly been done by others. So that you can do, but of course you can, and then of course based on that you can quantify the effects and then like use it even in an integrating fire neuron like Humphrey and Gurney has done, right? So that is an attempt, and then of course you can have a top-down model.
Yeah. One short question, I think it's more technical. What I didn't understand is about the role of GABA on plasticity. I thought that in slice there is no activity.
Yeah, there is actually activity because they stimulate.
Where is GABA coming from?
Yeah, so first of all, there is a lot of tonic GABA activity in these neurons. And that has been measured, and we have that in the model actually, but I didn't show it. So there is a lot of tonic GABA. But there is also, since they have a corticostriatal slice, they stimulate cortex, or these axons from the cortex, right? And then they measure in the medium spiny neurons. But if they measure in a fast spiking neurons, which they have done, that neuron spikes much earlier and much more. So they always have this feed-forward inhibition in their preparation, but of course not if they block with picrotoxin. Yeah, it is, sort of. Oh, but I mean, they just have an electrode that stimulates the input to the striatum in a quite unspecific way, and then they record from a single medium spiny neuron, for instance, or a fast spiking neuron or something. So I think actually that this, whatever, I mean, this is still just a slice preparation, so it's still not physiological, but I think that really this is an interesting example that it's very dependent on these details. And then one could question, how is it in reality? Because this is not reality either. Even if they have this GABA there, it's still not ongoing activity and so on. So it's a lot of challenging tasks in front of us, right?
in the results that you have shown for subcellular model, I see, so you connect this to a next level. For example, the subcellular signaling pathway, some modulation within that affects firing rates of medium spinal neurons. You have some
model? Yeah, I mean, we haven't done that, but I mean, that is, of course, where what we would like to do. And UPI has also tried to do that. Like maybe ERK is doing some phosphorylation of some potassium channels, or yeah, you can look at these things. So that will take some time, but eventually I think someone in the field has to do these things in a large scale way to really figure out that the principles that you believe in are really working, right?
Any further questions? Thank you.